Thank you for being here this morning. My name is Michael Van Heiss, and I get the honor of serving you by being on the Missio Nexus staff, and that is a huge pleasure. Well, there is a friend of mine, a friend and mentor from Sri Lanka. His name is Adrian Devisser. He's the father of Prashant Devisser, who will be speaking to us tonight. You won't want to miss that. And Adrian told me, we were sitting in Sri Lanka, and he said, Michael, he said, when I raise up church planters to go out throughout Southeast Asia, he said, there is one thing that I want them to know and understand. They must have a theology of suffering. They must understand what it means to suffer as Christians, as those who would carry the cross of Christ. And for those that they would be raising up in our churches, they'd understand that suffering is part of who we are as followers of Christ. That has always resonated in my heart. Well, for 23 years, Andrew and Norine Brunson lived and served and ministered in Turkey until 3 years ago in October. On one day, they were detained, and their lives were turned upside down, and for them, a pathway of suffering over a couple years would take place. And so this morning, and again tomorrow morning, we get the opportunity to hear from them and dive into their story a little bit. As part of this broad missionary family, we have prayed for them. We celebrated Andrew's release. And I would ask that you would stand with me and welcome Andrew and Norine as they come up here and join me on stage now. Thank you. Well, we're going to have a conversation up here. We've come into our family room together, and I want to talk to you too. Thank you again for being with us this morning and for sharing. It helps us better understand what's went on in your lives and how we can best serve the missionaries that we care for as a community. So thank you for being here. So first off, can you tell us a little bit about the time in Turkey before your arrest? So much of what's dominated the news has been the time in prison and what you went through. 23 years in Turkey, what was that like for you?
So I always say that there was not a dull day in Turkey, especially after we started, got involved in church planting in 2000, the year 2000. There were good days, there were hard days, but there was never a dull day. A lot of up and down. Two steps forward, one and a half back, sometimes two back, sometimes three back. So that's what it was. But I will say that overall there is an upward trajectory. So we were involved in, over the years, in evangelism, church planting, starting a house of prayer, and things like that.
Awesome. And what was it like as you engaged in church planting across Turkey? How was the receptivity to you? What was it like working with the Turkish people in the churches that you were planting?
Well, Turkey is the largest unevangelized country in the world, and the Turks are actually very hard. Even though there's a lot of freedom relative to other countries in the region, I think this comes from the spiritual legacy. Turkey was ahead of the Ottoman Empire, so they were the head of the Muslim world for centuries, and they spread Islam through the sword. And everywhere they went, that there were Christians, they suffocated Christianity as well. So there's a very dark spiritual legacy that the Turks have received. So they're hard. But at the same time, I think that there are very difficult circumstances in Turkey right now. It's becoming harder and harder. There's repression. And I think this is creating the conditions for people to begin to question things they wouldn't before. This is one of the things that came up at my trial that was used against me, but I would often speak in Turkey about how God will shake the foundations of the things that we trust in to get our attention.
Right.
And he'll do that in the States. You can have an economic crash, something like that. But when these difficulties come, I was talking to someone who has worked with Iranians for many years, and he says, there's a small window here. We don't know when it will end. There might be a regime change, and then things will become easier. We'll lose our opportunity, and that really comes. Mm. Because he said, then the Iranians will become preoccupied with other things.
Mm.
And so when there is difficulty, and that is increasing in Turkey, it actually creates the conditions for people to begin to turn to the Lord.
Wow. So leading up to the time of of arrest, were there things that you, looking back at this point in time, that you would think maybe we should have been more aware of? Were there things that you wish that you would have done differently over those 23 years leading up to that point in time?
So in 2009, the Lord spoke to Andrew and said, prepare for harvest. Mm. And that was a powerful word. And we said, Lord, how do we do this?
Yeah.
And so it was a time, it was a real shift of setting aside strategies, our own ideas. Andrew was a, you know, very, he had strategies. We're going to do this, this, this. We kind of set all that aside and said, okay, Lord, how do you want us to prepare?
Sure.
And we started to work in a very different way and really say, Holy Spirit, you lead us. And so as he started showing us a step and we did things, we felt confident that we were doing what he wanted us to be doing.
Yes.
The latest thing was, okay, prepare for harvest, but also among the refugees. So we realized this was a little bit more of a sensitive thing.
Sure.
But the Lord had shown it clearly, so we have no regrets.
Wow, that's great.
There's one thing personally that I would change going back.
Yeah.
So we'd been in Turkey for 14 years and already been involved in several church plants, and I was very project-driven. And at the 14th year, I moved from being project-driven to presence-driven, in the sense of running after God's presence. And I wish I'd done that before.
Yeah.
And I was, I think that focus is what put me in the position where I think God chose me to go through this imprisonment. I didn't choose it.
Right. Absolutely.
I know the Turkish government was very involved in it.
I
think they did it for evil, but God was involved in it. And there are any number of people who could have gone through this, but it just hit me this morning as I was thinking about it. This pursuit of presence and of intimacy is what set me up where God could, in a sense, trust me to go through this. I didn't trust myself. I really broke during the imprisonment, but he knew that I would come out of it. And
that's good.
I was breaking down this morning about that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Project focus to presence focus. That's excellent. I need to hear that. I'm sure many of us do. That's excellent. So 3 years ago, almost 3 years ago, in a few months, on October day, you were called down to a police station. Is that right? So what happened on the course of that day?
Well, we walked out happily thinking we were going to get our long-term residence permits.
Wow.
So we had not a care in the world as we walked down and had the rest of the day planned, come clean the house, get ready for guests. And then it was a shock to find out that they were deporting us. It can happen in Turkey, so, you know, it's not out of the realm of possibility. But in light of this prepare for harvest, we said, wait, God, you have us doing things. We're preparing for harvest. What's going on?
Right. And so 13 days together then in prison, is that right? And were you the only woman that was in that prison? Wow, that's incredible.
And thankfully they held us together and apart from others.
That's incredible.
A lot of fun.
Yeah.
It's actually very stressful because
they
said deportation, that should happen within 1 or 2 days. And then it was extended, we were cut off, there was no contact with anyone outside, so we wondered, you know, does anyone even know where we are?
Okay. And your three children were not in Turkey at that time.
I was so grateful that they weren't, that they were just safely in the States, although that was the hardest part for me, that we couldn't get word to them.
Right.
What must they be thinking? And in fact, they were thinking.
Wow. So what, at the end of 13 days when they released you, why did they release you? Do you know?
No explanation. I know that the chargé at the time had spoken to the Turkish government, said, look, it really doesn't look good. At least let the wife go.
Wow.
I don't know.
It's okay if you keep Andrew. So they kept me for 2 years after this. And I think there's a reason why they did. Usually they release... well, if they arrest an American for deportation, usually for 1 or 2 days, it will deport them. But they kept me. And people have asked, why? Why did they keep you?
Yeah.
So I think that they arrested me and kept me to intimidate other missionaries.
Okay.
And have them self-deport. And also to intimidate local believers. If we can do this to an American, we can do this to anybody. That kind of thinking. Then then, obviously, they ended up keeping me for, to use as a bargaining chip. But that's the Turkish side of the story. I think there's the God side that was not very clear to me.
Yeah.
And it's just, especially since I got out, it became clear. I wish he'd made it clear while I was in prison. It
would have
been
totally
easier. But is it, Norine mentioned, the Lord had spoken to me, said, prepare for harvest. And in 2009, and so in 2016, when we were arrested, and I think, did I do something wrong, Lord? Have you removed that assignment?
Yeah.
Has this been canceled? Are those words canceled? We're supposed to be preparing for harvest. This can't be. And then when they keep me imprisoned and it gets longer and longer, I thought basically my assignment had been canceled. But then as we heard about a prayer movement that began, I think a number of you prayed for us.
That's right.
This is actually pretty incredible. So what happened with the prayer movement is that an unprecedented prayer movement focused on one person started.
Yeah.
And as we heard about this, I began to think, oh no, I think I'm more valuable to God in prison than out.
Who knows? A scary thought.
Here.
Right.
Because what was happening is that so many people were praying with such intensity and for so long in so many countries.
Yes.
All over the world. And this wasn't just because of Norine networking and asking people to pray. God initiated this. He drove it. And it became clear that this was about much more than getting me out of prison.
Yeah.
That God was basically raising up his sons and daughters around the world to pray into one of the really dark principalities in the world.
That's right.
And it was setting up this power encounter. So I think that that was actually, my imprisonment was an assignment.
Mm.
That assignment to prepare for harvest, I thought it had ended, actually continued, and prison was part of it.
Yeah.
Because God was using me as a magnet to draw in prayer that's going to change Turkey and will also affect the region. So I say the Turkish story, they had their reasons.
Right.
But God was very much involved in it and was using this for what he's going to do in Turkey.
What he's going to do, and something that you had to learn as you've gone through it. And we so often want that big picture of what God's doing, but then he puts us in these situations, and we're taking it day by day. And for that period of time that you were in prison, solitary confinement, in a cell that was designed for 8 with over 20 people in it at a time, and then back to solitary confinement, that was a hard, long, wandering path during that time for you. And what did you find that, I know from what I've understood, the first year was really difficult, but then there was a change, and God started speaking to you.
The second year was also very difficult.
Okay, well,
let me just make that
sorry.
Clear.
I wasn't trying to minimize that.
God didn't begin speaking to me, actually. This was one of the big problems I had. What the expectation I had when I ended up in prison is, well, I'm going to just be flooded with grace. And I did have grace, but it was an unfelt grace. And I thought that for sure I would be hearing God's voice, that I would maybe have encounters with him. At the least, I would be filled with joy and a sense of strength. And I did not have that.
Yeah.
Instead, I felt very much the silence of God. And the expectation I had from reading biographies and maybe from testimonies was very different from the reality for me.
Yeah.
So what changed, and I went through a couple of crises, well, more than that, and I was suicidal a number of times. What changed in the second year was I made a decision with my will and disciplined myself to focus on my spiritual life,
mm-hmm.
to fight for my spiritual life. And there was a point where I realized I can't do much to fight for my freedom, but I can fight for my spiritual life because I'm on the verge of losing it. And if I lose this, if I lose my relationship with God, then I've lost everything.
Yeah.
And there was something that especially drove me to think about this was thinking of how many people go into a valley of testing. And the valley of testing is full of skeletons and of dry bones of believers who have failed those tests. And they may go to heaven, but they have basically become cold towards God, and they have lost the assignments that God gave them, the inheritance God intended to give to them here.
Yeah.
And I started to think, Lord, I'm on the verge of that, of just, you know, losing it in this valley of testing. I don't want to be one of these skeletons.
Absolutely.
And so I started to fight to press in and grab a hold of the assignment God had given me and not give up.
Yeah. I think I heard you say you didn't always have a Bible with you during that time in prison, and even times when you felt like the Lord wasn't speaking to you, but you did have a Bible, there was a certain sense of peace. Is that right, that you had when you did have one?
Yeah, I was held in five places, so it depended which place and at what period they let me have a Bible. So people have asked me sometimes, what was the verse or what were the things that really encouraged you as you read the Bible? And of course, they expect a different response. And I say, sometimes it was really dry.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, oh God, I'm reading 1 Corinthians and it's talking about how to run the church. This doesn't apply to me at all. I'm in prison.
Yeah,
you know, I'm the only Christian of a bunch of Muslims. I thought, how much of this doesn't apply to me? But actually, sometimes having the physical Bible in my hands and thinking, you know, this represents, you know, God's love to us, His grace.
Absolutely.
And the history of the church and the faithfulness of so many, even many who died so that we could have this word. So just having it physically in my hands was sometimes more comforting than reading what was.
Oh, sure, absolutely.
I know that doesn't sound very spiritual.
No, it does.
I also read what was in it.
Yeah, absolutely. The Holy Spirit speaks to us in multiple ways, and just the peace of having it is Him speaking to you. Norine, what sustained you during the time that Andrew was in the prison? What sustained you?
I had to lean on the Lord. I knew I couldn't do this on my own, and I obviously there were people praying around the world, but I just had to really press in and spend time before the Lord. And I spent a lot of time aligning myself with the words that God had spoken to us specifically, because when it comes to persecution, there aren't promises in the Bible to hold on to.
Yeah.
We don't know the outcome. So I said, okay, Lord, you know, if these words that you've given us through the years are true, then, you know, I'm claiming them. And I often said, somebody gave me a great prayer, just to say Mary's prayer, Lord, be it unto me according to your word. If these words we received are true, then I'm claiming them fully.
That's right.
But it's also a prayer of total surrender.
That's right. That's awesome. So after 2 years, 4 trials, right? And finally they convicted you, but they released you. So what was that like in those final hours as you waited in that courtroom to hear what you were waiting to hear, because you didn't know what the final ruling was going to be, right, when you were in there?
We had no idea that morning. So he had been on house arrest for 2.5 months, which was wonderful but not enough, and there were calls by the Turks for him to go back to prison. So when they came to get him that morning to take him to the last court session, he had a bag packed for prison, and they didn't let him take it. They said, and or he had one also packed for the U.S. They didn't let him take it, but we really didn't know. Court was going well that morning. Actually, some people were just, their case was falling apart. Break for lunch, and then they come back and they are starting to read this whole list of things against him and say, we want him sent back to prison.
Oh.
So there was an hour of hell, and you can tell about it.
It was an hour of hell.
It was an hour of hell. Yeah.
I mean, he's sitting.
Not much more to say.
We've come to this point. President Trump has put sanctions on. You know, so much his prayer, and he's sitting way in the front of this. It's this big basketball arena. He's sitting on his own. You know, I can't be with him. And I thought, oh God, you have to hold his heart, because I just, you know, it was clear they're going to convict him right
now.
He's going back to prison.
So they convicted you, but they released you, right?
I am a convicted terrorist, yes. And when that happened, I kind of faded out, and I was thinking, okay, I hope they send me back to the same prison I was in with the same, same cell. At least I will know the person. And then I heard, you can go now. And I, what?
Wow.
And basically, they convicted me. They gave me a prison sentence, and they suspended it, let me out for time served, and said, you can leave the country while the appeal process goes on, which was a nice way of saying, please leave as soon as
possible. Please leave, yeah.
It's like with Israel, you know, go.
Yeah.
And it was really a Pharaoh-type situation where he was hardening his heart. The president was making the decisions about me. And then God was involved sometimes in lengthening my stay in several times when it appeared that I would get out, and I didn't. And we think that, and it's a long evolved story, but to summarize it, I think God was saying at those times, I can let you out at this point, but if you are willing to stay, then there's something greater I will accomplish.
Wow.
And so there was one specific time when actually God gave me a dream with the exact date, and 68 days later on that date, the two governments made an agreement, and then the next day, Norine, she received a phone call that day, said, prepare your bags, get ready to go, it's imminent. They've agreed, the presidents. The next day, she wakes up with this song going just on repeat in her mind.
Yeah.
I surrender all. She says, okay, I surrender. I don't know what I'm surrendering.
Yeah.
The next day, she gets a call. They've canceled the agreement.
Oh.
Then I spent another 17 months in prison.
Wow.
And so this happened several times. And so I see if God had released me at the one-year mark, the prayer movement would not have become what it did. And so I'm glad that he didn't. I didn't know it at the time. It
That's
wasn't
right.
that clear. But I see what an enormous privilege I was given to be that magnet for prayer.
That's awesome. Well, in our last few minutes here, as I mentioned to you guys ahead of time, we've got mission leaders here. We have church mission pastors. We have people raising up missionaries to go to Turkey, throughout the Mideast. What would be your recommendation to them? Do we keep raising up missionaries? I think I know the answer to that one. How do we prepare people to face what they're going to face? What would be your recommendation to these leaders as they're preparing missionaries to go to the field?
So I have a session tomorrow, and I did want to talk about some of those things. For individuals who are in those countries, and I think this relates to the area of persecution, probably the questioning. When people would come to Turkey and tell me about their fears, what I would say to them is, well, you need to count the cost and be willing to die, assume you're going to die, and come over with that mindset, and then you probably won't, but at least you'll have dealt with these things.
That's
to
right.
Agree. Yeah, it sounds kind of heartless. I would say the same thing now, but with more humility and gentleness, because now I've been broken.
Yeah.
But early on in our time, and when we started in church planting, we had some serious threats against us, and we had to deal with this. And this is how we worked through it. We said, okay, God, we believe that you've given us this assignment. If you tell us to leave, we will be on the next plane out. If you don't tell us to leave, then you've given us an assignment, and we have to continue on in it.
Yes.
And we're going to assume that you will protect us unless you don't. And if you don't, we'll assume that it's because it will bring you greater glory not to protect us.
Yeah.
And so I can say that easily in 30 seconds, but it was a long emotional thing we went through, dealing with this, making this decision.
Yeah.
But after this, when there were threats, and there were threats, anybody who's in open church planting in Turkey is probably going to have threats. We had a gun attack against us in our church, against me. And when that happened, then we had this to go back to. We have decided how we're going to deal with risk.
That's right.
Now, I think that what we often call wisdom is actually can be cowardice. And God does give difficult assignments to his children. And we need to be obedient. So this is where it's important, yes, to be obedient and persevere, also to be hearing from God.
Yeah.
Because God intends for some to leave and for some to stay.
That's right.
And if God is saying stay and you don't, then it's disobedience and cowardice.
Right.
And if he's saying go and you don't, then it's foolishness. So we need to discern those, but also not hide our fears, you know, behind the idea of...
That's right. That's excellent. Thank you.
But I just will say this is the time for the Muslim world, and this is the time for Turkey. And I think as the foreign missionaries have a window of opportunity, but there's an increase in deportations, and it's not going to last long. And then the Turks will have to go through a hard time on their own.
That's right.
Also, we need to be willing to take on risks.
Yes.
To put ourselves in danger. I say this as someone, obviously, who's now suffered some. I don't understand persecution, why God doesn't intervene more often.
Right.
He allows some of his children to die, as you're going to see in a video shortly.
Yep.
Sometimes I think it's more difficult to live for God than to die for God, actually.
Yeah.
I would rather have died than live in prison for the rest of my life in a Turkish
right.
prison. So those can be difficult, too. But there's some, God allows this. I don't know all the reasons why. But some of it is because of the reward that's coming, the fruit that will come from it
yes.
that we don't see. We don't see the whole story now.
Yeah.
And so it's worth it. And another thing is somehow we learn to identify with Jesus. I don't understand it completely. And another thing is when we're willing to place ourselves at risk and to suffer for Jesus, then we display his worth.
Yes.
That he is worth it and that he is worthy of it.
That's right. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Well, let me pray for you, if that would be okay, and then we'll transition here. So, Father God, I thank you for Andrew and Norine. We thank you, Lord, that you are sovereign over our lives, that even when in our flesh you seem distant in a way, you are there, you are leading, you are governing everything that is taking place. Everything is in your hands, and how you have shown this truth about you through their story. We pray, Lord, that you will renew them and sustain them and even help them balance out their travel and activities that they can find rest and healing during this time of their lives. We praise you, God, for what you have done. We praise you that you heard the prayers of your saints and at your right time you released Andrew and reunited him with Norine and his family. Father God, we know that there are many around the world today that sit in prisons and face other persecution for their faith. We hold them before you, Almighty God, in the name of Jesus. We pray for their protection. We pray for their release. And most importantly, Jesus, we pray for your name to be glorified. We pray for the sacrifice of many would lead to the salvation of untold number of souls, that we can rejoice together in heaven with them. So we praise you. We glorify you in the name of Jesus.